we've got a pretty full show today, haven't we, Dan?
Yeah, we've got a lot going on today. We've got the this beautiful 1983 Gibson Les Paul Custom from the Norlin era.
It's a Norlin era,
which John has been doing his research on. He's going to give us the background on what to deal with Norlin, and I know there's some controversy over them. We've been playing around with these Thomas Winspear picks as well today, so there'll be some jamming you'll hear with that. You know, they can't talk too much about Plex, but you know, we're going to go into a bit about that.
Yeah, well, Tom's very kindly sent these over to us. These we've got the is Ice Grip, which is the sort of flagship pick model that he does here. This one here, which is, you know, it's just different kind of forms of plastic, really. But this one feels kind of, I don't know, like almost, it feels a lot softer than it actually is.
They're great.
Yeah, so they're pretty good. So we're going to be using them throughout the episode today. Yeah. So if you use Jazz 3s, you're probably going to find this is quite an easy transition. Both of these that I've got here, the amber one as well, which I actually like a little better.
A little bit bigger, but yeah, similar kind of thing, you know.
But one thing I will say to you is if you are into your like pinched harmonics, it's super easy for that because it comes to such a
sharp
point. I don't know whether James can pick that up on the camera, but it's a very, very sharp point. And I guess that's
pretty good for your picking as well, you know. Should we talk about the Norlin?
Let's talk about this. So we've got right here a 1983 Gibson Les Paul Custom.
Ooh.
Okay, so what is special about this, or what is noteworthy? Well, let's quickly talk about some of the negatives of the Norlin era, right? It's a bit of a strange place to start, but the reason for that is if you do a search for Norlin era Les Paul or Norlin era Gibson, it tends to be quite negative stuff.
So I was looking, there's a lot of forums with people saying some bad things about them.
Now, Gibson, I think, is a one, they're really on their own with this. Like, there's so many of, like, well, obviously, you know, people like say pre-CBS and all that with Fenders, but with Gibson, even to this day, it'll be like, you need to get the 2013 Les Paul, or don't get one from 2006.
Like a fine wine or something, you know, good years and bad years.
And I think the truth of it is that really, you're going to get good and bad ones from
any year.
From any year, absolutely. Now, with this, okay, what makes this one particularly special is this is a one-piece mahogany. I'm not sure about the weight relief. There's possibly some weight relief in it because it's not super heavy, and you'd imagine from that era, a mahogany body would be like, I don't know, it could be like 12
it's
pounds.
Like Swiss cheese kind of vibe.
Maybe the Swiss cheese weight relief on that, but again, it is just one piece. It's not the pancake that you sometimes see from that Norlin era.
It's not massively figured on top. It's got a little bit of figuring, isn't it, on the?
You can see that, actually. Yeah, that which is kind of, yeah, that's true, actually. I don't, the camera's not going to be able to pick that up, but it's you can see the top a little bit, and you can see it's a three-piece top on there. Now, in that era, tended to be a maple neck, three-piece maple neck on that, but this one's mahogany, ebony fingerboard, and the most important thing on this guitar, I would say, the Tim Shaw pickups. Now, these are really important because Tim Shaw, just an engineer at Gibson, but he was given the task to try and recreate the PAF pickup from the late 50s, that, you know, very famously in the bursts. Now, he got this very, very close. Now, at the time, there was no sort of fanfare for it or anything like that. It was just, here's the task, go and do this. They were in there. It wasn't until much later that people were like, these pickups
there's
are
something really good
really,
about them.
Really
yeah,
nice.
It was interesting what you were saying about the, because Norlin were, this is a, it's a, I think a bit of a convoluted story about big corporate conglomerate company taking over what was quite a traditional guitar maker in Gibson, and they're looking at ways of saving money. So that's why they brought in three pieces, breaking, so it was less kind of craftsmanship, more like the Telecaster in a lot of ways, where it could just be sort of printed out really quickly and really cost-effectively.
Well, it's interesting that you say that with the Telecaster, because maybe not even just necessarily just the Telecaster, but I think they were probably looking at Fender, Fender's model on a whole, because CBS had done the same thing just a few years earlier. They had bought Fender. There was a lot of supposed, you know, cost-cutting things that were put in there, although I wouldn't have minded having a, you know, a nice 67 large headstock Strat. It was fine for Jimmy.
Yeah, that would work for me. I mean, you were saying the Firebird, for example, was that was Norlin era.
Well, I think that, you know, that's the thing. Well, not the original Firebird, but like you've got like the Firebird 4 and all that sort of stuff.
Well, so you can see there's it's made out of three pieces of wood, and they kind of they don't hide that or from it. You know, was that the original design, or was that a Norlin thing?
I think with that one, what I'm trying to remember is which Firebird it is, because you know you get like there's like the Firebird, Firebird 2, Firebird
5,
there's all that sort of stuff. So there was one that came out, or maybe even a couple of them that came out during Norlin era. You will see that it's those different
cost,
parts that are
cost cutting.
That are stuck together. But there was a lot of crazy designs that came out as well during that period. Go and check out some different like Norlin era Gibson products.
Yeah, if you type it into Google and click images, you'll see all kinds of weird stuff.
Yeah, because you know there wasn't a really popular time for like the Les Paul. That's why they even stopped making them for a little bit. But
crazy, isn't it?
But there's some really sort of under the radar Gibson designs that are well worth checking out. But this is what we've got at the moment that we're going to be having a little go with. So let's hear what this thing sounds like, eh? Mm. The guitar itself, I mean, some of the people that have used Norlin era guitars, you know, let's say like Randy Rhodes, he was definitely used on Norlin era. It wasn't 83, it was probably more like 75. Zach Wilde as well. But so it is quite difficult, you know, to have a guitar like this in your hand and not play.
You can really hear those pickups, man. But you can hear how good they are.
They are really, really nice. I'm really trying to dig in here, just so you can really hear them. But yeah, this particular guitar, I don't know whether it's just over the years or whatever, the frets have just kind of got worn down a little bit. It might be that, or it could be...
Do you know, I found that when I was playing it earlier, when we were jamming, it was a little tricky, a little bit slippery and sliding.
I think that's it. When the frets are a little bit low, it's hard to be really accurate on your bends and on like vibrato as well. You can make it come out, but you need to work a little bit more. There was a design in the 50s on the Les Paul Custom called the Fretless Wonder. It might be that was what this was supposed to kind of replicate. That's typically what Les Paul would actually be using. He preferred to have very low frets. But
you've got that set up in nines as well.
It's got nines. So I'm cheating here.
It's slinky. Yeah. The action's really, really low, and it's got those that kind of really short fret. So it's a slippery guitar.
Definitely is. I mean, the thing is as well. Obviously, like that's with a little bit more of a high gain. We've got it set up here with the EVH. But if I roll off some of the gain a little bit here, just to hear what the tone's like, just a little bit. So, really got like proper nice vintage tones.
There's no harsh frequencies in that, is there at all, man?
You do want to crank it. That might just be me.
No, you want to crank it.
You know, it's just so nice, but I think it's one of those ones that with the pickups like that, you know, you can really just go nice and light. Or again, and you can hear this got like a lot of bite to the tone.
Yeah, it breaks up nice.
Yeah, clean it right up a little bit. I'll hand it over to you just a second. You have a wee go, eh?
Oh no, I'm jamming this all the way through our jam, man. Sounds beautiful. What's our version then, John?
I think I would take it.
How much are they worth?
For something like this, I think really, it's kind of how much someone's prepared to pay. I think if you're lucky, you're going to get maybe like 1,800, 1,900, something like that for one. Yeah, you know, you might get one for that, but it may be, depending on the condition, it could be double that.
Well, what's a brand new Gibson Les Paul Custom?
Brand new Gibson Les Paul Custom.
2.5, 3.
It could be that as well. That can be anything from $2,000 all the way up to like $6,000 or $7,000.
You could get a vintage 83 for the same price as a brand new one.
Not to discourage anyone from Gibson's products.
Absolutely not. No, but, you know, vintage. If you're depending on what type of player you are, obviously a lot of work's already been done to settle the guitar in. There'll be some wear on the neck, so on a gloss neck like this, you can already feel it's a lot smoother than it would be. You know, it's got some wear and tear, which gives it character. The frets are worn down. You know, do you know, sometimes that can really that helps. You know,
I
think it's pretty much a bargain.
I think it really is a bargain, because with a guitar like this, and again, it's like we were saying that these eras, you know, they tend to have a kind of bad reputation, right? So that's what's keeping some of the prices down on something
that's
like this.
Good, you know, so if you basically search around and try and find a good one, you know, and there's bargains to be had in that era, right?
I think so. I think if you're, you know, if you're looking to drop a couple of £1,000, I mean, I know like with a secondhand instrument, you know, you need to know what you're doing on it. Obviously, you don't want to just sort of drop, you know, pull the trigger on something from, you know, something on eBay or whatever. Not that there's anything wrong with getting stuff on eBay,
but you just need to know what you're looking at.
But you know, it could just come in the mail and it's got all these different problems or whatever. You know, it's ideally, I mean, I've done it, so I'm a hypocrite to say I've never had a problem at all, but usually it's, you know, best to be able to just play these things. But 5 minutes with this and you would know, right, wait, I'm just going to take this, because this is like, you know, it's got the nice feel for it. It's got all the tones that you would want, classic Gibson tones, and probably a lot less than custom shop.
Yeah, I played a Black Beauty when I was in the studio a few months back, and it wasn't dissimilar.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that was a 72 or something like
that. Oh, really? Wow.
It was a real nice one.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and it feels very similar to play.
Again, it's you know, in that sort of era. Yeah, and I mean, the thing is, I think the thing is as well, is that just because you've got the low frets like that, you can still shred on it. You know, it doesn't really restrict you from playing like that on it as well. So
so what's our verdict then, John? What are we telling the people? Go out and try and find a Norlin. Don't be too worried about the Norlin era.
Don't write it off just because it's Norlin. They're fantastic instruments. You're going to get some good, some bad from every year. I think that's really the bottom line, isn't it? You got to try before you buy, and just because it's X year doesn't mean that it's bad.
But make sure you do your homework, because there's a lot more to buying a used guitar than meets the eye, you know?
That's for sure.
So I suppose we should now think about heading over to you at the garage with John Five.
Let's do that. Let's jump over to me with John Five at the garage. So we're here at the garage in London, and we're with John Five.
Hello, how are you?
Yeah, I'm not too bad. I'm not too bad. John, how are you doing?
I'm doing well. So I heard we were going to do a rig rundown, like a kind of a rig, like what I'm using and stuff, but there
yeah, we've got he's not lying. That is the entirety of his gig. He's really, I mean, and you've always had quite a simple setup, John.
Yeah, and I'll play it for you. Yeah.
Right, now that it was from that was Hill Hall, wasn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So it's just that's all you need is a little Marshall practice amp. We're just gonna mic this up tonight.
Now, because you just played Hill Hall there, could you tell us a little bit about this new setup with the Creatures, how that came about, and when we're gonna see a new album?
Well, I love doing instrumental stuff. I've done these instrumental albums for a long time. And actually, my friend Roger, who plays drums, was like, hey, we should go do some shows. And I was like, nobody's going to want to see that, you know. And but we did a few shows. We did some shows in America, and they were just really big. And so we just kept going. And, you know, we do it for fun. We don't do it for anything else more than just getting out there and playing music and having a good time.
Yeah.
And the audience understands that too. They have a great time. It's just all these different styles of music, and you know, it's a lot of fun. And with a new record, probably early next year, because I've been touring so much with Zombie and the Creatures, so I'll put one out probably early next year.
But the single is available now, yeah?
Yeah, and that, you know, there's no rules now, so I was like, I'm just gonna release a song and a video so people can enjoy it and stuff like that. So, and it's been working great because all the stuff is so visual. You know, people want to see you do it. They want to see. I think everything is so visual. Everything is YouTube and the internet and watching things, and which I love it too. So I thought, might as well do it that way. You know, it's. It's not to make money or anything. It's just for you know, for the people and for the love of guitar and music.
Well, you seem to be the type of player that's, you know, you seem to keep reinventing yourself. You know, there's like expectations. Maybe John Five's going to be this type of player. I'm going to hear loads of distortion on this new song or whatever. And then you come out and it's super clean country style. And I know that, and you have been very influenced over the years by. I mean, obviously. Telly's a very country style guitar, but I seem to remember like growing up reading the you know, like you watched a lot of like hip hop, and you enjoyed a lot of that, and I'm assuming that's where the name Hill Hall comes from.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. And in the video, it's just like the TV show, but like, you know, twisted a little bit.
the TV show on steroids.
Yeah. Exactly. The TV show in hell.
So, like you were saying, we were going to take a look at the rig. And it's a simplified rig. Well, it's not that, obviously. We've got a bit more on stage. But how does your solo sort of rig differ from like when you're doing stuff with Rob?
It doesn't differ that much. I think the only thing that's different is I'm using a wireless with Zombie.
Right.
And I use a wah pedal, Zombie, and that's it.
That's
but
it.
Everything else is the same. I always wanted to do everything with just my hands, you know?
Okay.
That's the only difference. It's just, I always want to be able to just go into a music store and play.
Yeah.
And not have a problem.
Of course, you know? Of course. And just to ask you quickly, you see with your signature Telly, I've noticed with a lot of your Telecasters, you know, you have, well, it's not there now, just to be edited, and it's not on this one, but the headstock is quite different on your Telly. What's the story behind that?
I love Fender, and I love Fender history, and there was a guitar back in the day in the 60s called a Maverick, and they had this crazy looking headstock, and I was like, that's a cool looking headstock. So I put that on the on my Telly, and it was a part of Fender history. And the Fender 12, the 12 string, kind of has that same kind of headstock as well.
Right, okay.
So I just thought it was so different.
Absolutely, yeah. No, that's fantastic. So your tour is just about to kick off tonight.
Yeah.
And then you're going to be heading to Glasgow, is that right?
I think so.
Yeah, so I think if you check John, it's john-5.com to get all the full details on the tour. You're doing like a little mini European tour in between. And you're touring with Rob Zombie at the moment as well, yeah?
The last show, I believe, is in Germany, and then I drive like 2 hours and meet Rob, and we start doing shows with Zombie.
Right.
So
fantastic.
It's cool.
Yeah. Well, check out the tour. Well, John's here. It's an exclusive tour. And thanks so much for taking a bit of time with us, John.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right.
Nice one. So did you enjoy that, Dan?
Yeah, it was good work, mate. Yeah, no, how was it for you? Did you enjoy speaking to John?
Yeah, it was good. I mean, at the time, it was a wee bit different from what we had planned, but John was very, very helpful and even gave us a little bit of playing there, which was very good, wasn't it?
So, always good, mate, always good.
Yeah, yeah,
well, as always, guys, please make sure you put your comments on here, and if you like what we're doing, share it with your friends. And I suppose that's all for the moment.
One final thing I just want to say, coming up quite soon, we're going to take a look at some retro pedals.
Oh, yeah.
Retro rewind type thing. Zoom 505.
Yeah, the 1010 for me. That was my first multi-effects.
So in the comments section, any classic pedals that you think would fit in that category? We're specifically looking at the oldies here.
Yeah, that sort of late 80s, 90s period of multi-effects in particular.
Maybe like a little cheapo, like first pedal that you got, stick that in the comments section. We're going to try and get a selection of those together and test them out, but
and see if they any good.
Yeah,
see if they stack up to modern effects.
That's actually the main point in this. Yeah. Are they any good? Because we kind of remember them being a bit mince, but
There might be some bargains out there for people, you know. So
there might be. So anyway, that's going to wrap up this week, and we'll see you next time.